You're listening to me right now on a set of speakers, or maybe on your headphones. How do those speakers or headphones work? Well, it turns out if you take a close look inside, you'll find a magnet and a coil of wires, which really doesn't explain anything. How does that make sound? Well, when we put a current through that wire, it can actually cause the magnetic field to change and the magnet to shake. And that shaking magnet moves the cone that produces a bunch of sound, which, to be honest, even though I know that, still, it kind of blows my mind that it can make the sound quality and characteristics of my voice or of your voice mind-blowing stuff. How does it generate this force? Well, it's all about the current and the magnetic field. And the resulting force is called the Lorentz force, which is exactly what we're going to study in this lesson. Listen closely. Let's begin by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll review the right-hand rule, which turns out to tell us the direction of the Lorentz force. Then we'll learn to calculate the Lorentz force, specifically the magnitude. The direction will be told by the right-hand rule. And lastly, we'll practice calculating the Lorentz force. Remember, in our last lesson, we learned that magnetic fields exert a force on moving charges. So if you ever have charges moving in a magnetic field, there's going to be a force there. And the right-hand rule tells us the direction of the Lorentz force, this force on those charges. Remember, the right-hand rule can be accomplished by taking your right hand, pointing your thumb straight up, your pointer finger straight out, and your middle finger to the left. Go on, lift up your hand. Let's do it. Thumb up, so you're giving me a thumbs up. Finger straight towards the screen. Middle finger out towards the left. Now you've made the appropriate hand gesture for the right-hand rule. Your pointer finger is going to go in the direction of the charges, and your middle finger is going to go in the direction of the field. Your thumb tells us the direction of the force, specifically the Lorentz force. Let's give you the definition. Lorentz force. It's the force on charges moving in a magnetic field. So we've already been thinking about this force. We can calculate the magnitude of this force with this equation. Now, force here is going to be in newtons, which we're pretty used to. This is the Lorentz force. Then Q, any guess what Q is? If you guess charge, you're correct. That's going to be in coulombs. That's the charge on the particle moving at velocity, which is going to be in the units of meters per second. And then B is the magnetic field strength. Now, technically, the magnetic field, the velocity, and the force are all vectors. Here, we're just looking at the magnitudes. So in some ways, it would have been more accurate to put the vertical bars everywhere, but it just gets clunky and messy. So just remember, we're looking at the magnitudes of F, V, and B. What's the units for our magnetic field? It turns out they're determined by Nikola Tesla. He invented the AC motor and studied magnetic fields. He actually made a bunch of money on these inventions, but then he kind of spent it all and invested it all in more inventions and eventually died broke. Sad times. But fortunately, he did get one reward, and that is that we named the magnetic field strength after him and Tesla's. So the unit for our magnetic field strength is Tesla, abbreviated with a capital T. All right, so here we have our equation. Now, like I said, F, V, and B are all vectors. That's the directions we're pointing with our fingers when we use the right-hand rule. And for this equation to work, velocity and magnetic field must be perpendicular to each other. If they're not perpendicular, you actually have to use a different equation, which we won't be learning. So this is just an equation that applies when they're perpendicular to each other, like in the right-hand rule. Notice force and charges are perpendicular to each other. There's a 90-degree angle between them. Charges and field are perpendicular. All three of these are perpendicular to each other. That's what happens in the case of our Earth's shield. Remember, here we have a bunch of charged particles flying towards the Earth, and they get bent by the Earth's magnetic field. In this lesson, we're actually going to calculate the strength of this force. This problem says a radioactive particle, and it gives us the charge, from the sun strikes our Earth's magnetic field at a velocity of 425,000 meters per second. That's a pretty fast particle, at a right angle. If the Earth's magnetic field is 25 UT, what does that mean? Let me just remind you that this weird little U is the Greek letter mu, and it stands for micro. So we read this 25 micro Tesla. Then we're asked, what is the Lorentz force on this particle? And we're told that 1 microtesla equals 10 to the minus 6 tesla. Okay, cool. A few notes to remind you of before we start working. One is that this force is actually a vector. So really, we're calculating the magnitude of the force and not the direction. Same with our velocity and our magnetic field. Those are both vectors, but we're just using the magnitude here. The other thing I want to remind you of is that we're at a right angle. So that means our velocity and our magnetic field are at a right angle with respect to each other, which is exactly the circumstances we said we needed to use this equation. Okay, so let's go ahead now and use our Lorentz force equation. First, let's write down the charge, which we have the Q, and it's given to us. Q equals 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. That's a charge we've seen a couple of times because it's the charge on the proton, and the negative version of it is the charge on the electron. So it looks like maybe this radioactive particle is a proton, but we're not told. In any case, we do know the velocity, and the velocity here is 425,000 meters per second. A very high velocity, but representative of the speed at which these radioactive particles can travel. Okay, then we have the magnetic field, which strangely enough is represented by B, and it's 25 microtesla. And remember that our magnetic field should be in tesla, so we're going to convert this here just to tesla. So we'll get rid of our microtesla, and we'll go to just regular old tesla. Get out of here, microtesla. We'll get a magnetic field of 2.5 times 10 to the minus 5 tesla. All right, great. Now we can actually calculate the force. We're just going to multiply these three things together. First, the charge, 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs, times the velocity, 425,000 meters per second, times the magnetic field, 2.5 times 10 to the minus 5 teslas. When we multiply all of that together, we're going to get 1.7021 times 10 to the minus 18. All right, now let's round for sig figs. Our magnetic field has just two sig figs, so we should keep just two sig figs here. That means we're going to round to 1.7 times 10 to the minus 18. And then the unit for force here is Newton, so we put a big N there. So that's the force on this radioactive particle. Now, that's a pretty small number because it's 10 to the minus 18. But remember, our radioactive particle is also going to be quite small. So given the size of the particle, it's actually a very strong force, and it will accelerate it quite quickly so that it doesn't move towards Earth. Thanks, magnetic field. All right, now it's your turn to give it a try. This problem says a charged particle, and again, it gives us the charge, flows through a coil of wire inside a speaker at a speed of 1.5 millimeters per second. If the magnetic field strength is 1.2 tesla, what is the Lorentz force? Assume the charged particle is moving in a direction that is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Okay, good, so it's at a right angle. Now, I want you to try to calculate this force. The one thing to keep in mind here is that the speed is given in millimeters per second, and we're going to need to convert that to meters per second. All right, pause the video and give this a try. Were you able to get it? The correct answer is 2.9 times 10 to the minus 22 newtons. Again, a relatively small force. In this case, the reason it can move the speaker is because there are many, many charged particles flowing inside that wire, which when they all combine together, generate a sufficient force to make all the sound you hear that comes from a speaker. Let's review what we've learned. First, we reviewed the right-hand rule, that thing that tells us the direction of the Lorentz force. Remember, you always take your pointer finger and point it in the direction of the charges that are moving, your middle finger goes in the direction of the magnetic field, and your thumb tells you the direction of the force. Then we learned to calculate the Lorentz force, provided that our velocity of our charges and the direction of magnetic field were perpendicular to each other. And lastly, we practiced calculating the Lorentz force. Hey, hey.